We'll be reading Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. The Lord had said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you."
As David mentioned in the announcements this morning, we are here permanently. We closed on our house Tuesday. We had our furniture and all of our things delivered Thursday. So we're here permanently. We had a painter come to the house yesterday to give us a quote on doing some work for us in the house. And he got there and I was apologizing for the mess in the house, boxes everywhere, state of disarray. And I started to say, we just moved into the house a week ago. We've just had our possessions in here for a week. And it dawned on me they had only been delivered 2 days before. We're here permanently, but we're still in kind of a fog as we're trying to unpack and figure out where everything goes in the spaces, the new spaces of our home. But even though we've only been in the house a few days, we have our Christmas tree up. It has lights on it. And the boxes with ornaments are placed around it in preparation of being put on the tree. Because Christmas is a big deal in our house. Yesterday, we went to the grocery store, and on our way to the grocery store, it was apparent to me that Christmas is a big deal to a lot of people. Lots of homes already have their decorations on the outside, and in the grocery store, lots and lots of Christmas-themed merchandise for people to buy. And I've noticed something over the years. When I was younger, it seemed like Christmas was more obviously religious. I can remember driving and seeing lots of scenes in people's yards with the manger and the wise men and animals and seeing more of those kinds of things as we were out and about. And over the years, it seems that emphasis around Christmas has diminished. But nevertheless, this remains a time of the year when a lot of people stop and think about Jesus' birth. You probably know that even though the Gospels indicate that Jesus' birth most likely took place during the spring, this is a time of the year a lot of people stop to celebrate Jesus' birth. And Christmas, therefore, has become an occasion when people think about Jesus. And there is associated with that a time in December called Advent. Advent is the religious holiday using the Sundays in December that focuses on the events leading up to Jesus' birth and concludes with a celebration of Jesus' birth. Now, even though we understand there's no intrinsic religious significance to Christmas, even though we understand that Christmas is not the day that Jesus was born, any time that people stop and think about Jesus, think about his birth, and think about the significance of his birth for their lives, I'm all for that. And so this month, we're going to use the Sundays in the month of December to trace the events leading up to Jesus' birth, but we're going to do it a little bit differently than you might have seen done before. We're going to focus on those events in a very big way, beginning in Genesis, leading up to Jesus' birth in the Gospels. And this month, David and I are going to each Sunday take aspects of that storyline this morning. We're going to focus on the events in the beginning of the Bible, in Genesis, leading up to Abraham. And in that section, focus on the introduction of God's purpose behind his creation of humanity. The problem that humanity sin poses for God's purpose. And the promise that God issued to Abraham that we find in that passage in Genesis 12 that was read for us just a moment ago. That focuses on God's solution to the sin problem. Next week we'll move forward. We'll look at Israel, God's plan for the Israelites as a people through whom he would begin to work the accomplishment of that promise. A promise that finds its fulfillment in Jesus. The third week, David is going to take us through the prophets in the Old Testament and look at some of the things they add to this growing development of God's promise to resolve humanity's problem through Jesus. And then on this fourth Sunday, we're going to read a harmony of the gospel accounts of Jesus' birth that focus on how Jesus is the fulfillment of those things and point us to the significance of Jesus meaning for our lives. So that's what we're going to try and do on the Sunday mornings this month. And we're going to begin this morning by focusing on the introduction of those materials in the beginning of the Bible. Before we do that, however, let's take a moment and pray together. Father, we're glad that we can be here this morning, that we can gather as a family and be reminded of your goodness, especially as we see your goodness displayed through Jesus. We pray that as we focus this morning on the events leading to the promise of Jesus, that you help us to better understand who you are and who we're supposed to be because of who you are. Help us to focus on Jesus, to be transformed by that focus. Help us to rally around him and to draw one another into closer relationships with each other and into relationships with you. And we'll pray all this through Jesus. Amen. In Genesis 1 and in Genesis 2, we are introduced to God's plan for humanity. And this is where we're going to begin because of something that we see Jesus commenting on in Matthew chapter 5. In Matthew chapter 5, we have the beginning of a section that we commonly call the Sermon on the Mount. Matthew chapters 5, 6, and 7. And in the beginning of this sermon that Matthew records, Matthew chapter 5 and verse 17, we have an important comment that Jesus makes. Jesus comments in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 17, "Do not think that I've come to abolish the law or the prophets." And that phrase, the law or the prophets, is a Hebrew idiom for all of the material in the Old Testament. He says, "Do not think that I came to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them." Jesus makes it very clear that he is not some new, unprecedented development in history. He was very clear that he's the conclusion to a much larger story that's been in the works for a long time. And that story has its origins in the beginning of the Bible. So when we encounter things like, for example, that scene in Luke's gospel where the angels in Luke 2 are singing about God's blessing the world because of Jesus' birth, that scene is the conclusion to a storyline that begins back in the beginning of the Bible. And we're going to focus on that beginning this morning, and it begins in Genesis chapters 1 and Genesis chapter 2. And in that section, we read about God's creation of humanity, and we gain some insights into his purpose for the creation of humanity. And there are two things in particular that I think that are important for us to consider as we think about the opening scene in our Bibles. The first one is when we look at the creation account in Genesis chapter 1 and in Genesis chapter 2, we find that God created all of the creation to revolve around humanity. And along the way, particularly in Genesis chapter 1, we catch glimpses of that. For example, in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 14, as we read about God creating the lights, the sun, the moon, the stars, he makes the observation in the text that those things were created to designate seasons and days and years. They were created for the purpose of marking time for our benefit. The organization of those things was designed by God for the people that he made to populate his world. But God didn't just make a world for people. More significantly, he made the world for people so that the world could host the relationship that he intended to have with the people he made to populate the world. Of all the things that are part of the creation, humanity alone has the distinction of being made in God's image. In Genesis 1, 26, 27, and 28, we can read about God's announcement of his plan to make mankind in his image and how he gave a unique responsibility to mankind to rule over his creation, to partner with him in governing the world that he made. And the Garden of Eden is a special location within the creation where God's relationship with humanity was to play out. God made us to be in a special, unique relationship with him, distinct, different from every other thing that he created and every other being that he created. But even though God bestowed a great blessing on humanity by making them in his image and giving them the opportunity to rule over his creation as representatives, when we get to Genesis 3, we see the problem. Instead of choosing to remain in the relationship that God created them to enjoy, humanity instead chose to rebel against God. They chose to do what they wanted to do rather than what he designed them to do. And this introduces the sin problem that plagues God's creation. And the sin problem expanded beyond that initial rebellion of Adam and Eve in Genesis 3. Genesis 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and 11, in a very compacted way, unpacks the sin and its hostile takeover of God's world, showing how it moved from Adam and Eve to Cain and Abel to Lamech, a descendant of Cain, and how as it moved in successive generations, it became more and more egregious, more violent, more destructive. Until eventually when we get to chapter 6, God looks at the world filled with the people that he made in his image to be like him and to rule in ways that mirrored his character. And he says, their thoughts are only evil continually. And so he purges the creation, he purifies it with a flood and recreates it with the desire to restore it to its purposes. But what we find is that humanity again returned to its sinful practices. We see this beginning with Noah's family as they come off the ark in Genesis chapter 9. And it expands when we get to Genesis 11. That's part of the point of the story of the Tower of Babel. All of humanity is focusing on its own selfish interests again, like they did in the events leading up to Genesis chapter 6. And that raises, I think, an important dilemma. Humanity that God made to be his representatives, to be in a special relationship with him, have consistently rebelled against him. And we have the rebellion again in chapter 11, which raises the question, how is God going to respond? That's when we get to chapter 12, the passage that was read for us just a moment ago. God doesn't respond with another punishment. He responds with a promise to bless the world and to bless the people that he made in his image. And this introduction of the blessing in Genesis 12 is very vague, not very specific. He promises to a man named Abram that he's going to bless him. And through him, he's going to bless all the families of the earth. And beginning at that point in Genesis, we have a series of stories that begin to show the ways in which God is going to accomplish that promise to bless humanity. And this promise includes using Abraham and his family to be the vehicles through which this blessing would be extended to all of the world. As we move through the text, we find God coming back to Abraham and expanding the nature of the promise, giving him more insights into what was a part of God's plan. And one of those places is in Genesis chapter 22 and verse 18, where God speaks to Abraham and he says that through Abraham and through his seed, through his descendants, he's going to bless all of the people of the earth. Now, Paul looks back on this in Galatians chapter 3, and he gives us a very important insight to this promise that we read about in Genesis 12 and in Genesis 22. Paul, in the book of Galatians, was writing to Christians that were struggling with some people who were teaching different things than Paul was teaching. They were teaching different relationship between things like grace, faith, law, and works. And so in the material that Paul writes in the book of Galatians, he spends some time explaining the purpose behind the law of Moses that God gave to the Israelites. And in his description of the purpose of the law, he introduces it by making an observation that God's promise to Abraham predated the law of Moses by some 430 years. And then he adds another very important insight in Galatians chapter 3 and verse 16. In referring to that passage in Genesis 22 and verse 18, where God tells Abraham the promise initially given in Genesis 12 to bless all the families of the earth would come through his offspring or through his seed. Paul looks back and he says, I know what God had in mind because of where he was in God's plan, because of the things that God was doing for him through the Holy Spirit. And listen to what Paul adds to our understanding of that promise introduced in Genesis 12. Galatians chapter 3 and verse 16, he says, now the promises were made to Abraham and to his offspring. It does not say, and to offsprings, referring to many, but referring to one, and to your offspring, who is Christ. It was Paul's understanding that this promise to bless the world through Abraham and his family was the introduction of God's plan to bring Jesus into the world. This is Paul's reflection on the same thing that Jesus himself said in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 17. That he didn't come to destroy the law of the prophets, but he came to fulfill them. He's the conclusion to that long story beginning in Genesis 12. A story that introduces us to God's purpose for humanity. Beings that he made in his image to be in a special and unique relationship with him. People who then rebelled against him, and his response to the rebellion was to issue a promise to resolve the problem, to draw them back into a relationship with him. And because Jesus is the fulfillment of God's plan to bless humanity, when we come to that scene in Luke 2, beginning verse 8, where the angels, in announcing to the shepherds in the field the birth of the Messiah, begin singing to the shepherds, singing glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom he is pleased. They are singing that song because Jesus is the fulfillment of God's promise to bless all the families of the earth that we find at the beginning of our Bible, places like Genesis chapter 12. That's the beginning of the story of Jesus' birth. Now we understand God didn't write the Bible merely to be an engaging story. He wrote it to communicate important things to us. And part of the responsibility we have as people who are learning to understand the biblical story is to ask ourselves, what kind of lessons can we take from this material and apply to our lives? And as we think about this introduction to the story that has its fulfillment in Jesus' birth, there are three things that I want us to think about this morning. Insights that I think we can have into God's character that will help us better appreciate who He is, and understanding who He is, appreciate who we are made to be as people made in His image, as people made to be like Him and to be in a relationship with Him. And the first thing that I think we find is in this opening section of the Bible, we find God focusing on blessing more than punishing. Yes, there's the punishing part. That's part of the story of the flood during Noah's time. But when we get to Genesis chapter 12, we find that God focuses on blessing humanity, and that forms the core narrative that drives the Bible's story as we move forward. And we find places like John chapter 3 and verse 16 that I think offer a really good summary of this feature in God's character as revealed to us in the Bible. And we're familiar with John 3:16. We could probably quote John 3:16. John 3:16 and verse 17, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish but have eternal life." But verse 17, not so commonly known, but equally important in understanding who God is. John continues recording Jesus' teaching here. Jesus goes on to say, "For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through Him." And it's this mission to save and not punish that was behind God sending Jesus that James reflects on in the ending comments in his book, James chapter 5 and verse 11, where he says that you've seen the whole purpose of God. Speaking to people who are experiencing persecution and hostilities, he says, you understand what God's purposes are, and His purposes focus on mercy and compassion. The God who reveals Himself to us in the Bible is a God who's driven by an intention to bless people and to do good to people. And that's really important, because if that's the focus of our God, that means then we must be people whose goal is to also bring blessings into the lives of people around us. And we do that by learning to live in ways that echo the life and character of Jesus, who models God perfectly for us. We also find that this promise introduced in Genesis 12, a promise that has its fulfillment in Jesus, develops over a very long period of time. Some 1,500 years are part of the development of this promise. And if you think about the Bible story, all the material packed from the introduction of that promise in Genesis 12 to its fulfillment in Jesus' birth, you will probably realize there are a lot of people who caused a lot of problems and did a lot of disobedient and destructive things along the way. God remained faithful to that promise, even though the people that He was making the promise to, much of the time, didn't seem to have any interest in the promise or in God Himself. And what we find as we work our way through this is an overwhelming emphasis on the love, the deep and genuine love that God has for each and every one of us. That's what motivated Him to undertake this plan. That's what motivated Him to remain faithful to it, even though the people that He was faithful to so very often were not faithful to Him. And it's that kind of love that John writes in 1 John chapter 4 that characterizes God, he says, ought to characterize us. As we read about the expression of God's love for us through Jesus, through His plan to bless people through Jesus, it should impress upon us our responsibility to be people who love those around us like God loves us, so that we can be people who bring blessings into their lives like God promised to bring blessings into everyone's life through Abraham beginning in Genesis chapter 12. As we better understand God, we better understand who we are supposed to be. And I think there's a third very important point that we can see in these opening section of the Bible. God is sovereign. He makes the world, and throughout the Bible, He's pictured as king who rules with unquestioned sovereignty over everything and everyone. And as sovereign ruler, God has the right to issue commands that he requires everyone to follow. But what we find in the Bible is that God interacts with people primarily on the basis of a promise more than commands, because he has love and respect for every individual. He gives us dignity because of the relationship that he wants to have with us. That should impress upon us our value to him. And if we have that value to him, we should extend the same value and dignity to every person around us, regardless of who they might be, regardless of how our society might think about them, regardless of how our communities might consider those individuals. Every person is invested with inherent dignity. And throughout the Bible, we're reminded of the ways in which God treats people that expose the dignity that he believes that we possess, that he invested in every one of us. And we're to live in ways that are reminders of that dignity, ways in which we show respect to each person around us so that through our treatment, they gain insights into the character of our God, because our lives reflect his identity, reflect his character. This month, as we work our way through the material that leads to Jesus' birth, as we focus on the origins of the Advent event, we're going to see things that remind us about who God is, most especially as he's revealed through Jesus. And as we focus on those things, we gain insights into who God is. It should impress upon us the character of life that God created us to possess. So the question then for us, as we work through these materials, should be, what kind of life do I live? What's the character of my life? Do my relationships with the people around me in my home, my neighborhood, in my workplace, reveal the character of the God who made me, the character of the God who issued the promise to bless all of humanity? Or does my life reveal a character that's different from his? Does my life reveal a character that's consistent with the problem that motivated the promise that God issued beginning in Genesis 12? We understand from both personal experience, things that we have done to others and others have done to us, that we as a whole make bad choices. We make selfish decisions to do what we want, regardless of how they might impact the people around us, without concern for the will of God. We call that sin. And it requires an addressing. And as God is sovereign, he's going to be the one who eventually will address those things. But because he's a God marked by love and grace and mercy and compassion, he sent Jesus to offer us an alternative to the judgment that he says will eventually come. Through Jesus, we have the chance to become new and different people, the chance to reenact Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection in our baptism, the chance to be identified as God's children in the same way that Jesus was at his baptism. And with that comes opportunity for blessing, as well as the responsibility of living consistent to the character of God as he reveals to us in the Bible. So the question this morning is, are you an individual whose life is consistent with God's character? And if not, what changes are you going to make to be that kind of individual? Whatever your need might be, this morning you have a chance right now to come forward and let it be known as we stand and sing.